right, this is John Colo at growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you guys coming at you from my backyard garden. And what you guys are getting a nice background shot of is my beautiful raised bed here with over 60 pepper plants. And there's probably like over 50 different unique varieties in there. Be sure to stay tuned for an upcoming video on where I got all these unique, crazy varieties. You know, and you guys could get them too, actually, so that's really cool. And I'm really looking forward to some of the peppers it's producing, including I got the guaranteed world's hottest pepper according to the Guinness Book of World Record. That might mess you up. But in any case, what we're doing in today's episode is we're gonna do a Q&A, questions and answers. So if you do have a question you want to get answered on a video like this, you may try to email it to me over the YouTube email system or put it on my channel discussion page. I check the regularly and pull some of the questions out of there to do the Q&As that I do here. Another way, if you really need to get your question answered, is I have a Fiverr campaign, which is you're gonna pay Fiverr $5, of that I get $4, and then I'll give you a call anywhere in the United States for 10 minutes and answer any questions you have to the best of my ability. Now, I don't know everything, I know a lot of stuff, but yes, and I'll talk to you for 10 minutes, you know, for simply $5, so that way you could be assured to get your questions answered. Now, with the money that gets paid to me, I don't take any of this stuff. This money goes back in to basically other Fiverr members in the community to get my videos transcribed. You know, I want to make the videos that I put out that are full of education and information available to people that are hearing impaired, or more importantly, in other countries and may not understand English, but when they get a transcription, YouTube will automatically translate that into foreign languages so that they can now understand and you know, get the gist of the message, because it's probably not gonna be perfect, that I'm trying to spread in the world, is to, you know, simply take the control of your food back into your own hands by growing your own food and teaching you guys that it really is that easy. All right, so let's get into today's questions. The first question is from Bearded Ombre. Hey John, love your videos. I'm just getting started on gardening here at my house in Windsor. I'm thinking about using the earth box or city pickers, and I was curious where you got the Happy Frog soil conditioner. I've been to a few of the places that are mentioned on their site, but they only have the potting soil. I was wondering where in Sonoma County you got the Happy Frog soil conditioner you had in your video about these boxes. Thanks again, and keep up the awesome work. Or by chance, would you suggest any of the compost that Sonoma Compost offers that would work in its place? If you're ever in Windsor, feel free to stop by. We'd love some input. Thanks again. Cheers, Jason. All right, Jason, so what my recommendations are for you, being that you're living in Windsor, California, you know, I'd recommend a few things for you. You know, now, the videos I make depends on the materials I have and what's available, and I use the best of the stuff that I have available at that time. Would I recommend, you know, the Happy Frog soil conditioner for you? Not necessarily. If I was you, what I would do specifically is this. I'd go to Monster Gardens in Rohnert Park and pick up some of their Air Max. That's basically their coconut core that's been washed like 4 times, enriched with all kinds of good stuff that I approve of. And then I'd go to Sonoma Compost and I'd get the Mallard Plus mixture. And I'd mix those two together. You know, aside from that, also, I'd also go to Friedman Brothers locally and pick up a bag of the Worm Gold Plus worm castings. I'd use that as well. It's $12.99, probably the best price I've seen anywhere, actually. And then I'd also go to LaBallister's, and I have a video on that. They're in Santa Rosa on Sebastopol Road, I believe. And I'd pick up a bag, or actually two, of the rock dust. So I'd get a bag of azomite and a bag of the glacial rock dust, also known as the Gaia Green glacial rock dust. And I'd mix those together in the right proportions. Mostly, you know, basically be like half compost and then half the Air Max. And then I'd add in smaller amounts of the rock dust, both rock dust and the Worm Gold Plus, and you're gonna have one of the best soil mixes that's ever been created, and you've done it all locally for fairly affordable. You know, these are for your container gardens. That being said, if you live in Windsor, you know, I know Windsor is a pretty sprawling place. I know you probably got a house in a housing development with a good amount of land, so why restrict yourself to growing in a container if you have the space? I would highly encourage you to actually build some raised beds and grow in raised beds so you could grow far more food than just a small container. Unless, of course, you're in, you know, some kind of condo or apartment and you don't have the space to build a raised bed. Windsor is a great place to be growing stuff, and you want to be getting in your tomatoes now as soon as possible for the most yield. I'd recommend, you know, I love growing cherry tomatoes, and they just yield and they're so fruitful, and I'll be picking tomatoes, you know, for the whole season. All right, next question is from Moni Noki. Hello, I have a question about cow manure. We live in an era with a lot of cows right next door, and we have cows that have a nice large area of grass to eat. Would you recommend that we use that manure since we can see where it comes from? Thanks. All right, so, you know, my view on manure, you know, manure is one of the things that's largely used in organic farming. When you think organic farming, you know, you think, okay, manure is the fertilizer, and when you think conventional farming, you think, you know, chemicals in a box or a package, you know, is the fertilizer. And so while I like manures probably better than the chemicals, personally, you know, I think we can go to the next level on organic gardening than just using manure, right? I want to model nature, and in nature there's no, you know, gardens growing in, you know, raised beds of cow shit or manure or composted manures, right? You know, what there is mostly is composted plant matter. So whether that means trees, barks, leaves, vegetative, you know, stuff, that's what, you know, most of how nature works, and with some added manures when there's animals roaming and passing around, right? So that's what I'm trying to duplicate, and that's what I always encourage you guys to do. You know, use mostly plant-based source compost, you know, and add in some manure if you want to do that, you know, but try to get the majority of your stuff, the plant-based stuff. And I know some of you guys don't live in a place where you can easily get composted plant material. I happen to be in one of those. It's difficult to get some good composted plant material. You know, I've found some ways to do the best I can, and you know, I have used a little bit of manure, and I don't really have a problem with manure overall in general, as long as it's in a percentage of your mixture. I don't think it should just be straight manure. The main problem I have with manure are two things. Number one, the contamination aspect of the manure. Luckily, you could see the cows eating the grass, so you know that they're eating grass is the mainstay of their diet. This is excellent, right? The next thing that you may not know is there are certain herbicides that they could spray on grass, and it's called clopliids or something, that basically it's a systemic herbicide. So when the cow eats the grass or when the cow eats the hay that the herbicide was sprayed on, it goes through the cow or the horse or whatever, and then it gets pooped out of them, and it's still existing in their manure. So the manure is contaminated. Then even if they compost that manure at high temperatures, that nasty herbicide is still persistent in there. And then you take that manure, put it in your garden, you try to plant your tomatoes next year, then nothing grows. And you're like, John, I followed your instructions on how you grow with using the rock dust, and nothing happened. It didn't work. Well, I can't, you know, I can't do nothing if you got a bad batch of manure-based compost, you know. So this is why it's very important to know the source. You know, before you just get the manure, talk to the farmer, talk to the person that's growing it, you know, growing the cows with the manures, and find out, are they taking antibiotics? Are they getting supplemental feed besides the grass? Are they spraying anything on the grass? Are they eating GMO corn or soy? You know, so now that goes through the cow, and then you get the residual waste product of GMO corn or soy in their manures. And, you know, I'm not gonna make any judgments on this stuff. All I will say is that it's not my first choice to use composted manures that have GMO remnants in there. You know, I wouldn't do it. Would I do it if that was like the only thing I had and I lived in the desert and there's nothing except some composted manures with some GMO remnants, which will allow me to grow? Absolutely, but once again, not my first choice, not my second choice. It's probably down near the bottom of my list that if this is the only option, that's what I'm gonna do, right? So that's one aspect, the contamination aspect, whether that's GMO residuals, whether that's, you know, herbicides, whether that's, you know, antibiotics that the animals are being fed. These are all potential issues. Now, another issue is the E. coli or bad bacteria issue. Just recently, organic mangoes by Purity were recalled. Like, how come organic mangoes are being recalled? Well, they found Listeria or whatever, it's a bacteria that causes food poisoning in people. Now, any disease a mango tree could have out in nature, whether it's powdery mildew or whatever it is, like, plant diseases like can't get cross-contaminated to people or animals, right? It's kind of cool like that. So even if you see your plants kind of messed up, if you eat it, you're not going to get sick with white powdery mildew. Think if you ate some white powdery mildew leaves and you got all this white powder and stuff on you. Hey, maybe you never need to buy makeup again. But nonetheless, they can't share diseases. But the problem with why these got contaminated, and I don't know exactly the reason, I could just kind of guess. But what, in my opinion, happened is that, you know, improper handling or, you know, improper, you know, manure use. So they did maybe manure-based composting under the trees, and maybe they did raw manure instead of composted manure. Maybe they still had some bad bacteria. Maybe the mango was dropped off the tree into manure, touched the manure, got contaminated, then they put it in a box and sold it to you. So that way the mangoes could now get affected. I know when, you know, the cantaloupes were had a big outbreak with food poisoning because of cantaloupes on a conventional farm years ago is because of the, you know, feces of manure that washed down and contaminated the fields. It could also be improper hygiene, you know, protocols of the workers, you know, picking the mangoes. Maybe they're pooping in the fields or whatever, and, you know, they didn't wash their hands after they went to the bathroom, and then they, you know, because they're eating animals, once again, if you have animals and eating chicken, for example, you know, even the chicken that you buy from the grocery store is not sterile, man. There's all kinds of crazy bacteria, and, you know, a lot of the bacteria will pass through you and come out the other end, and then that could contaminate your food or somebody else's food, you know, if you're a farm workers. That's why proper hygiene is very critical. Of course, if you're not eating these chicken and animal products, you know, and other things that can be contaminated with, you know, potential pathogens, then you're not gonna have a manure or your poop is not gonna be contaminated so that you can't contaminate nothing else. So maybe all farm workers should start eating only plants, and then this would drop the incidences of food outbreaks, potentially. The final thing I wanted to say about the manure products is simply this. There are no regulations on any manure-based product aside from human manure, right? No regulations, so there are no laws, there's no testing. They could be contaminated with heavy metals, they could have systemic herbicides or pesticide residue, you know, systemic GMO residues, or even, you know, bacteria counts that are out of this world, but they still bag it up and can sell it to you because there are absolutely no regulation. Anybody could put any kind of shit besides human shit in a bag and sell it to you. And, you know, many, it's quite unfortunate that many organic gardeners just go to Home Depot and buy the steer manure and just, you know, put it on their garden thinking, oh yeah, I'm organic, that's what I'm supposed to use. You know, that's not my solution. And be sure to check out some of my other videos for, you know, how I like to fertilize my garden, because I'm not going to get into it in this video. All right, so hope that answers your question. You know, I always encourage you guys to do the best you can. If the manure from the cows, all you got, then yeah, you know, and it's clean, go for it, you know. Personally, I would rather start having a compost pile myself and start generating my own compost and bring some in as needed. All right, next question is from Daryl Clevenger. Hey, John, can you link us to the pages from your main page, or at least maybe come up with a page that can show us all the many different discounts we can get by being your watchers and faithful followers? Anyways, keep up the great job. I have watched every single video thus far, and I'm eager for more every day. Thank you, Daryl Clevelinger, Indianapolis, Indiana. All right, Daryl, I apologize, but I don't have any specific area that has all the discounts listed. You know, before I make videos, if I really like a product, I'll talk to the manufacturers and let those guys know that, hey, man, I got like 140,000 people that follow me. I've been viewed over 20 million times. I'm the most watched internet gardener online. I'm going to make a video about your product, and would you like to have a discount in there that'll, you know, help get product out to people, but more importantly, provide a special service to my viewers? Because I really value you guys, really, you know. You don't understand, like, I nail the freaking manufacturers and people hard, you know. I'll scour the internet and see, oh, well, this manufacturer gave a 30% discount once. And so, like, then I'm like, they're like, oh, we'll give your viewers only 10%. I'm like, no, I'm not gonna do that. You know, we need to get that to 30% so that my viewers could have the best discount that I've ever seen. Because, you know, I wanna get you guys the best price. I know gardening can be a quite expensive hobby, right? And it doesn't have to be. You don't have to spend money to buy some of the products that I recommend. But, you know, some of them are good and some of them are not so good. And, you know, my job is to simply share those with you and share my experiences with them. And if you choose to purchase them, great. You know, the ones that I really like, you guys definitely know if I really like it. And, I mean, some of these ones that I recommend are ones I actually use all the time in my garden. I have a stash of some of the different, you know, Boogie Brew compost tea. I have the Boogie Blue water filter. I have some of the John and Bob's products. You know, I use the rock dust religiously, and yeah, so I mean, they are really good products. But once again, I want to say that you don't need them. I have a video that explains how to make some of these products or for free, or to get them for cheaper if you're into that style gardening. You know, my whole thinking is, you know, hey, I got some extra money. You know, people spend money on their internet bill, on their hobbies of drinking out at the bar, and I mean, whatever people hobbies are these days, on their car and fixing up, and that's cool if you want to do all that, I don't care. But I'm telling you, my hobby is gardening. I'm putting the money into my garden, because once again, as I've said before on my show, that the garden is the most important investment you can make ever in your life, right? Like, yeah, better than putting money in the bank is to grow high quality food that you can eat, that number one tastes better, and number two is going to yield more, but number most importantly for me is that it'll allow you to have the highest level of nutrition so that you'll be the healthiest. Fact of the matter is clear, I've said it many times, standard Americans eating junk food, processed foods, foods out of traditional agriculture systems that are only adding three main minerals for the most part back in the soil to grow the crops you're eating. This makes nice large crops, but they're not so nutrient dense. You know, for example, a green bean picked out of my garden compared to one bought from the store could, number one, taste better, but more importantly, number two, have 50% more protein. Same green bean. All that's different is how it's grown, when it's harvested, when it's eaten, when it's consumed. And that's just the protein. Other nutrients like the magnesium and some of the trace minerals could be twice as much as well on certain nutrients as well. So when foods have more nutrition, they have a better taste profile, and this is why, you know, I recommend and encourage certain products that can get higher quality food for you. And if that's not your goal, that's cool. I understand you don't need to buy nothing, right? Because I know some people get, oh, you put their, oh, John, you got to cheat gardening, not about products. You know, I understand, you know, everybody has their place. Some people want to garden for free. That's great. Just pick and choose the stuff that you watch from me. Don't watch every video. You know, I like to use some products to my advantage. And I'm soon actually going to have a video at the 2014 National Hardware Show, which is coupled with the National Lawn and Garden Show, with about 20 booths that had some amazing stuff. So you're gonna have to wait for that video, man. Cool stuff this year, I found. Probably the most exciting year for me of all the years I've been. But yeah, I don't have a page that specifically says all the discounts, because the discounts are specifically for my viewers. And if I had a page that said all those, some of the manufacturers even are talking about, like, John, we found that, like, you know, regular people, not your viewers, are using the discount codes and stuff, and they don't want that to happen. They just want, you know, this for a special bonus for you guys, right? My viewers and stuff. They don't want their regular customers to use it. So, you know, at this point, you just got to keep watching my videos, and you'll find those videos where I have the discount, you know, in there, in the links, and where I talk about it in the video personally, to get you the exclusive special discounted prices that I really, really negotiate hard with the retailers for you guys. All right, next question. Made by Steve. I have a question. I'm getting ready to do a major dirt replacement in my garden, at least 15 yards of garden dirt. Right now it's hard clay, and was wondering if there's something I need to look for. The suppliers in my area have a few different three-part mixes. I'm in the Kansas City area. I also have a short video of my garden and am renting a bobcat, and I'm going to do several tiers on a hillside and should end up with about 3,000 square feet of garden when finished. So any advice on the dirt would help. Thanks, Steve. All right, Steve, so instead of dirt, I want you to think of soil. Dirt is what, you know, you track in your house and then you have to vacuum up, right? That's dirt, right? Soil is something totally different to me. You know, soil is something that's alive, right? Dirt, in my opinion, is not alive, right? So you already got clay. Clay is actually a good medium, but the problem is we need to bring in some organic matter and get some bacterial in there. So, I mean, the main things that I'd encourage you to look for, you know, I don't know if you're going to mix this with your current, you know, soil, or you're just going to grow in the soil that you're bringing in. I have other videos on, you know, buying soil and specifically what to look for. You want to get, see if they have food soil web testing, number one. You want to check out the, you know, the profile, the assay, or the testing of the soil you're considering to bring in. I would encourage you to try to get one with a lot of compost. Many different soil places, you know, cut things with sand and all this kind of stuff so that they can make more profit, which is quite sad. I will soon have a video on the soil that I filled this bed with, where I'll go over a few talking points. But be sure to check my past episodes. I have a really good episode where I went to the video's titled, like, the best compost or soil in Texas. And I went to a place down in Texas and filmed a video, and if I lived down there, that's the soil I'd use, hands down. And check that, because I share some tips and tricks on getting some of the best soils for you if you're going to a yard or a place. You know, another a really easy thing to do if you don't want to compare all these, you know, charts and all this stuff, is simply go to the place that you're going to buy the soil from, right? And get samples before you buy truckloads, right? Say, hey, can I have like a 5-gallon bucket full of your soil? And get 5-gallon bucketfuls of soil from each of the places you're considering. Take it home and try to grow some, I don't know, arugula. Arugula is something that grows really fast. And sprout and germinate arugula seeds in the pot with that soil. And see what happens. See which soil the plant grows fastest in, right? This way you'll know, like, okay, man, this soil, even though they say it's really good, the arugula, it was like stunted growth and it didn't grow as fast. I know this one, that was the lowest price, the arugula took off. I mean, this is known as a pot test, you know? Don't smoke pot before you do your pot test because you might get messed up. This is just a common sense approach to figure out which is best when you don't know because you don't know how to read all these assays and all this kind of stuff that, you know, I would know how to read. I mean, yeah, super simple, do a pot test. Figured out once and for all. Hope that answers your question. Next question is from Isabel Wolanski. Hi, in one of my raised beds at home, a bunch of sprouts have popped up and me and my mom don't know what they are. There are two kinds and one kind looks like tomato seedlings. There are only a couple of the tomato ones and they are all scattered everywhere in the bed. My grandma lives with us, is currently visiting home in the Philippines, but she told us that she planted something before she left. Asking her over the phone which bed she planted, etc., isn't going to work since she is too old. If they are weeds, I'd like to pull them immediately, but I'm afraid there's something else. I don't want to pull tomato seedlings out. What should I do and how can I tell for the future reference? All right, Isabel, so the only way you're going to know what plants look like is by two ways. One is definitely better than the other. Number one, you could try to research it, take a picture of it, and then try to do a Google image search to see if Google could compare the image you took with some other images. So that's a really quick and easy way. You could pick up like a book and try to figure it out, but that's, you'd probably be there forever. I mean, the only other way to know for sure is to grow them out. You know, I love growing things out. I got some little mustard plants growing here that I actually didn't plant, and I'm like, I see it come up, and like, instantly I know, oh, that's mustard, I've seen that before. And this is one of my joys of gardening. You get to learn so many new things. So grow them out, don't pop them too early, you know, as long as they don't go to, you know, flower and set seed, it's no real danger of growing a few extra weeds in your garden for a little bit, right? So, I mean, I love to let some of my volunteers grow out until I could identify them, and if I don't know what they are, I'll let them grow out until they're more mature, and then I can identify them. Then they get pulled if I don't want them, and sometimes actually I'll pull them up and then actually repot them in a little pot and then move them to another bed so that I could, you know, plant them somewhere else. So yeah, one of my joys of gardening is to learn what new volunteers are coming up. But yeah, I got some cool ones in the back actually, right next to my tomatoes. And I'm like, what are these? These are in the melon family. They're either like a cucumber or a squash, you know, or some melons. And I'm like, and I know that much. And I'm waiting. I'm pretty sure they're honeydews. But now we're taking bets, right? I mean, here in Vegas, we're taking bets on if it's going to be honeydews or not, because that's what I think it's going to be. And I'm only going to know once it starts to get a little bit bigger, and then I'll know for sure when it puts on the fruit. Yeah, so that's probably my best recommendation for you is grow them out and see what happens. All right, so that brings us to the end of today's questions. Hope this was helpful for you guys. You learned a few things along the way as well. Be sure to stay tuned for an upcoming episode, hopefully real soon, on the one product that can increase your crop yields by up to 400%. It's totally amazing, something I never learned of before, and it's something quite natural that if you don't want to buy, you can even make yourself, because I got the expert to tell and share his some techniques on how to do it. That's probably coming up in the next or the next after the next episode. So hopefully you guys enjoyed this episode. Once again, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And remember, keep on growing. All right, this is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you. We're here on a field trip to Los Angeles, California. We're here at like 58th Street here in Los Angeles.